It's no secret that history has seen its fair share of terrible politicians. Occasionally, however, somebody might be remembered as a great statesman or a beloved national treasure, despite being totally undeserving of their reputation. These are the respected politicians who are actually terrible people. Woodrow Wilson wasn't just the 28th president of the United States, he was also a straight-up racist. And sure, American attitudes towards race were generally backwards back in the late 19th and early 20th century, but Wilson really was something else. Under his leadership, the federal government was resegregated, despite having actually made some decent progress toward racial integration. He also fired almost all of his black employees and unilaterally defeated an amendment at the Versailles Convention recognizing the principle of racial equality. On top of this, he wrote a history book that was sympathetic to the KKK. So much so, in fact, that it was even quoted in the infamous film Birth of a Nation. Wilson also had a problem with women, specifically women who wanted to vote. It's actually pretty ironic that the 19th Amendment was ratified while he was in office. He certainly wasn't one of its most enthusiastic proponents. Indeed, Wilson once told his staff that, "I am definitely and irreconcilably opposed to women's suffrage." One of Wilson's aides later remembered that Wilson had once insisted, "A woman's place was in the home, and the type of woman who took an active part in the suffrage agitation was totally abhorrent. Even a woman who simply spoke in public made him feel, in his words, chilled and scandalized." As far as politicians go, Nelson Mandela is considered by most as close to a saint as you can possibly get. As it turns out, however, his wife, and later ex-wife, Winnie Mandela, was less saintly, to say the least. Their marriage survived almost three decades of Nelson's imprisonment, but fell apart in 1996 when it was revealed she had cheated on him with her younger bodyguard. Like her husband, Winnie was a bona fide revolutionary and even earned herself the title of Mother of the Nation, but her methods were downright horrific. Winnie was known for her involvement in the so-called necklacing of police informers and apartheid collaborators, a method of execution in which a gasoline-soaked car tire is placed around the victim's neck and set on fire. She even once famously said, "With our boxes of matches and our necklaces, we shall liberate this country." Over the course of the 1980s and 90s, Winnie was implicated in a number of kidnappings and killings, and was also convicted of theft and fraud in 2003. When she went before the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in the 90s, the Archbishop Desmond Tutu said of her role in the fight against apartheid, "She was a tremendous stalwart of our struggle, an icon of liberation. Something went wrong, horribly badly wrong." Winnie, for her part, apologized to the commission for her actions.
"It is true. Things went horribly wrong. For that, I am deeply sorry."
Many of Lyndon B. Johnson's more unsavory exploits are pretty well known, such as his penchant for exposing himself in an attempt to assert his dominance over others. But Johnson's power games went so much further than that. Johnson's relationships with the women in his life were particularly mired by abuse and control. One biography of the 36th president claims that he would pick out his wife's clothes, select her haircut, and force her to wear lipstick. His secretaries received the same treatment, being made to do their hair certain ways, with Johnson even picking out their bathing suits. He even told them how much hairspray to use. And of course, there was the fact that he frequently got naked in the presence of his colleagues. One writer once said that what would be sexual harassment today was part of the everyday atmosphere of Johnson's office. Men had it almost as bad too, with Johnson frequently abusing his Secret Service staff, forcing colleagues to follow him into the bathroom, and even exposing himself to journalists when he couldn't answer their questions. Although his name is practically synonymous with peace, freedom, and civil rights, many of Gandhi's beliefs were backwards, even for his time. For example, his sexual proclivities were risque enough that one political rival once referred to him as a, quote, "dangerous semi-repressed sex maniac." Despite practicing celibacy for much of his life, Gandhi often had young women sleep and bathe with him, even when his wife was still alive. But that's not nearly the worst that Gandhi got away with. Having lived in South Africa for over two decades, Gandhi was given more than ample opportunity to indulge in his own deeply racist beliefs. In short, he hated the country's black population and wanted them to be segregated in pretty much every public space, from hospitals to trains. He almost always referred to black people by a racial slur and believed it was desperately important that whites remain in charge of the country. Gandhi's views on women were also abhorrent. He believed that menstruation was, quote, "a manifestation of the distortion of a woman's soul," and proudly wrote that women should be held responsible for any attacks they suffered. He even went so far as to say women who were assaulted had, quote, "lost their value as human beings," and that a father was well within his rights to kill a daughter who had been assaulted so as to restore honor to their family. Many US presidents have cheated on their wives, but John F. Kennedy might well be the most notorious, having been described by historians as a compulsive womanizer. JFK slept with movie stars, secretaries, and plenty of people in between over the years, including Mimi Alford, one of his own interns.
"Was he exploiting you?" Well, it certainly was an incredibly imbalanced relationship and not a good relationship in hindsight, looking back.
And on top of all that, he seemed to pay little mind to the hurt it caused his own wife. Jackie Kennedy is remembered today as having been the perfect first lady and an ever-dutiful spouse. But Jackie was fully aware of many of John's affairs, always making it perfectly clear to him that she wasn't happy about it, and even considered divorce on two occasions. One of these took place in 1956, when JFK left his pregnant wife at home to go on a Mediterranean cruise. Then, when Jackie gave birth to a stillborn daughter, her husband couldn't even be bothered to cut his vacation short and come home to her. Every time she thought of ending her marriage, however, Jackie was talked out of it by her family. Her sister pointed out that their father had cheated on their mother and that had worked out all right. Meanwhile, her mother said it was simply the price Jackie must pay for being married to a powerful man. British Prime Minister Winston Churchill may have been best known for leading the UK's stand against the Nazis in World War II, but his less savory side is no secret either. Many critics have accused Churchill of holding deeply racist views and pursuing destructive imperialist policies while in office. Fewer people, however, will be aware of his early battles against the women's rights movement. Churchill was vehemently opposed to women getting the vote, and the suffragettes singled him out as the one politician they needed to bring down, in some cases, literally. In 1909, for example, an activist named Teresa Garnett came at him with a whip and attempted to force him into the path of a train. Around the same time, after a group of suffragettes had interrupted one of his meetings, Churchill said, "Nothing would induce me to vote for giving votes to women." But the suffragists didn't give up. They attended his speeches, heckled him, and generally made as many disruptions as they could. Christabel Pankhurst was actually arrested after one such incident, and Churchill said he hoped sitting in jail would, in his words, soothe her fevered brain. Nonetheless, the suffragettes won out, eventually. In 1918, women over the age of 30 were given the vote in the UK, but only if they or their husbands owned property of a certain value. It wasn't until 1928 that all women were granted fully equal voting rights to men. Strom Thurmond was so beloved by his constituents that he was a continuous presence in the Senate for 49 years, making him the longest-serving senator in United States history at the time of his retirement. But for all his many electoral successes, Thurmond had a serious dark side. In 1948, Thurmond ran for president on a states' rights and segregationist platform and even managed to get over 1 million votes. He then continued his fight against equality after getting elected into the Senate. In 1957, President Dwight D. Eisenhower proposed a handful of basic civil rights laws, but Thurmond was having none of it. He filibustered all on his own for a whopping 24 hours and 18 minutes, which to this day is still the longest speech in Senate history. But what makes Thurmond much worse than your run-of-the-mill racist was that he was also a raging hypocrite. The whole time that he was declaring that black people and white people should be separated, he was hiding a mixed-race daughter of his own. Thurmond was 22 years old when he had impregnated a 15-year-old black domestic worker. He ignored his child right up until she was 16, after which he started giving her money, partially to keep her quiet since he knew the scandal could end his political career. The truth of Thurmond's hypocrisy wasn't fully revealed until after his death in 2003, when his daughter, Essie Mae Washington Williams, finally came forward. Nicolas Sarkozy was president of France from 2007 to 2012, and perhaps one of his most infamous traits was his love of all things glamorous. Known as the Bling Bling President, Sarkozy frequently wore Rolexes and custom-made Italian suits. He also divorced his second wife and quickly married the wealthy model Carla Bruni. Perhaps inevitably, then, it was money that eventually led to Sarkozy's political downfall. Liliane Bettencourt was the heiress to the French cosmetics company L'Oréal. She was also absurdly wealthy. When she died in 2017, she was the wealthiest woman in the world, with a net worth of nearly $40 billion. But Bettencourt was also accused of secretly giving hundreds of thousands of euros in illegal campaign contributions to Sarkozy and another government minister. This, however, was far from the only illegal money Sarkozy was accused of snapping up. In 2018, he was questioned by the police after taking cash from the late Libyan dictator Muammar Gaddafi to finance his 2007 electoral campaign. Around $6.2 million was allegedly handed over in three suitcases stuffed full of cash. Overall, Sarkozy was thought to have received 50 million euros. This, of course, wasn't just incredibly shady, it was also outright illegal. As such, in 2021, he and two co-defendants were convicted of corruption and sentenced to 3 years, two suspended and one in prison. Everyone knows about Bill Clinton's dealings with Monica Lewinsky, which is perhaps one of the most famous affairs of all time.
"I did not have sexual relations with that woman."
But although there was a severe power and age imbalance between the two, that affair was at least consensual. According to a number of women, however, that wasn't the case with many of Clinton's other encounters. In 1991, Clinton was attending a conference in Little Rock as the governor of Arkansas. Afterwards, he invited a woman named Paula Jones back to his suite. After talking for a few minutes, Clinton allegedly reached out and grabbed her hand, pulling her close. He then ran his hand up her thigh and tried to kiss her neck when she tried to stop him. After Clinton undressed and started making demands, Jones refused and fled. Kathleen Willey is another of Clinton's accusers. In 1993, she went to the Oval Office for professional advice, where Clinton groped her, grabbed her crotch, and rubbed himself on her. But the worst accusation of all comes from Juanita Broderick. In 1978, Broderick was volunteering for Clinton's gubernatorial campaign when he invited her to have coffee in his hotel room. Once there, she claims he assaulted her. Clinton was never charged for the incident, however, and to this day, it has largely been forgotten. If you or anyone you know has been a victim of sexual assault, help is available. Visit the Rape, Abuse, and Incest National Network website or contact RAIN's National Helpline at 1-800-656-HOPE-4673.